You know how many stores that we have in the United States? We have enough stores that for all 330 some odd million of us, each one of us has 45 square feet. 45 square feet, a 9x5 space of store that belongs to each and every human being living in the United States, including those that are living in retirement centers and can't get out, and the rugrats who live in people's homes, mom and dad doing the shopping. It's a lot of stores. It's a problem. Particularly when you compare us to any place else in the world and realize that we have 5 times more stores per square foot per person than any other country on the globe. And we still build them. So how are you going to be something? How are you going to do something nobody else does? How are you going to be something of significance? So that your customer comes and wants to do business with you. And so my question this afternoon is, are you trying to be something that you're not supposed to be? Are you trying to do something with your store that you shouldn't be trying to do? And maybe that's the problem that you've got. So I want you to think back to being a kid. Because in your childhood is the solution. When we were kids, if we weren't playing baseball, football, something out in the neighborhood, you'd go somewhere to a lot. And on this lot would be a rise, a hill, a mound. And you would go out there and you would play King of the Hill. It was a fun game because it didn't require bats. Football didn't require anything. All you had to do was just be there. But the problem with it was that winning the game had a lot to do with your strength and your size. So when I was a kid in school, I was 5'6" and a little tiny skinny kid. So it was not one of my favorite games. Yet if I wanted to be with all the kids in the neighborhood, you had to go play. Kind of like retailing. It might not be your favorite game being the small kid, but if you want to be in the game, you got to go out there and play. So how was King of the Hill played? Well, you knew who the big kid was. You always knew who the biggest kid was that lived in the neighborhood. And they would always want to play the game. And they would walk out and stand on the hill. Come on. Come on. And there would be a kid who played football or basketball or something who was tall enough, broad enough shoulders, that would go up and take that person on. There might be 2 people who would take the big kid on. And then there's the rest of us. Did you sit and just watch the game, sit on the sidelines, or did you try to find a way to play the game? So while the big one's up there defending, the other people are coming after him. But then there's a whole lot more of us. So the third person, and we're going to call this person the flanker, would kind of watch the two of them go at it. And when they would kind of get to one side of the hill, the person playing flanker could kind of come up on a part of the hill, never to take the top, but could kind of command a position. And then all the rest of us, well, we could kind of jump in every once in a while and grab someone in the back or push someone from the side or wait till the flanker was distracted with someone else and then we could come at them. Retailing is the same thing. But too many of us think that we're the person who's defending, or we think we're the person who's attacking. And so what we do is we go after the people who are the big kids in the game. And just like when you played King of the Hill, there's not a chance that you're going to possibly win. Now, this happens all over the marketplace today. So going totally away from the pet industry, but the stuff that you experience every day, let me give you some examples. The King of the Hill in the car industry is Mercedes-Benz. If you're wanting to add a feature, something special about a car, and you're not Mercedes-Benz, then you compare yourself to Mercedes. And when you look at the kids who are the hip-hop crowd and they're wearing the pieces of jewelry, if there's a piece of jewelry that's got a car logo on them, you know, no self-respecting hip-hop person is going to wear an emblem on their chest that says Kia. They're all going to wear a piece of jewelry that says Mercedes-Benz. And yet Lexus will go after them. In my community, the Lexus dealer goes after them by a very unique style of how they market. What they do is they buy tickets to concerts, and in a couple of weeks we have the Grand Prix coming to our town, and they'll buy tickets to this and they will sell them at a discounted price to the Lexus owners, but they'll sell them to them in blocks of four, not two, because they want the Lexus owner to take a couple of friends with them. And you go to the concert, no matter who it is, you go to the Grand Prix, whatever the event is. But all of a sudden, when you are the guest of someone who owns the Lexus, what are you surrounded by? A lot of Lexus owners. And maybe you owned a Mercedes. But all of a sudden, you're experiencing what it's like to be in a Lexus. And there's a third company out there who's nowhere near as big, but takes and wants a piece of the market. And they're called BMW. And BMW calls themselves the ultimate driving machine. To the point that when they had the last Mission Impossible movie, BMW paid no placement fees for that car to be there for Tom Cruise to drive. The people who made the movie asked for the car. And then there's a fourth one who comes in, and they're the gorilla who takes just a little tiny piece of the marketplace. And they're called Volvo. And for many years, there used to be John Houseman who promoted the car. In that deep English voice of his, he would say, 87% of all Volvo owners are college educated. The other 13 are just plain smart. In today's advertising, Volvo says, we have the highest safety rating of any vehicle out there. So here's a couple, and maybe they've had a Mercedes before, but then they have a child. And he's thinking, oh, I gotta feel loose a little bit, I want a BMW. And she's saying, you're not putting no baby of mine in that BMW. We're gonna get a Volvo. Four people, all competing for somewhat of the same dollar, and somehow all four of them knowing their place and being successful at what they do. Pepsi. Except Pepsi's number two. Coke is the king of the hill. Do you know there was once upon a time Pepsi actually made good inroads into Coke's marketplace? Some of us are old enough to remember the Pepsi challenge. Filmed in the grocery store. Okay, I see the heads nodding. And people came in and took drinks. Did you know that the contest was rigged? Did you know that the contest, the Pepsi challenge taste test, was actually rigged? It was. Pepsi knew they were going to win. Those of you who don't like his Pepsi, those of you who are Coke drinkers, why don't you like Pepsi? What's the problem with the Pepsi? Too sweet. So you remember the Pepsi challenge? How big was the drink, the glass that you drank from? About that big, about 3 ounces. It's a little hard for Pepsi to be too sweet in 3 ounces. When you first get a drink, you like the sweetness. The problem is it's a 12-ounce bottle. The gag on the sweetness comes in somewhere down the line. That's how the contest was rigged for Pepsi to win. But that's the big one going after the other two. That's the two big people in our industry going after each other. But then there's this third company out there, 7-Up, the Uncola. No caffeine, never had it, never will. The t-shirts they have today with their three colors on them. And on the front it says, make 7. Across the back it says, up yours. What is the 7-Up slogan? What is their slogan? Make 7-Up yours. Just the placement of the words on the t-shirt to make it entertaining. But yet, Coke has a 7-Up kind of drink, and they never thought to do it. 7-Up was the company that said, we're going to flank. While people are fighting the cola wars, here's a piece of the market for us. And then you had someone come along called Mountain Dew. And Mountain Dew took a very different place. They are a more youthful drink. They are the kids' drink. They are the highly caffeinated drink. Totally different taste than the other ones. And yet the marketplace has room for all four drinks. Hertz, number one, we try harder. Number one car rental company out there. Avis, what is Avis's slogan? We're number two, we try harder. Avis, when they started the campaign, said, if you rent from Hertz at the airport, they've got long lines because they got lots of customers. We don't have that many customers, so there's no waiting lines to get in to rent a car from us. Then they said, you know, when they have all those customers, surely that when you've got that many customers, you run out of cars. We don't have that many customers, so when you come to our short line counter, assuredly we will be able to take care of you. Now here's the oddity of what happened with Avis. Avis, we're number two, we try harder. Avis, when they came up with that advertising campaign, was actually the number six car rental company in the business. They leapfrogged everybody to become the number two, because they were the people smart enough to figure out, here's the problem with being number one. Putting it in their face, something that they cannot defend by being the big kid of the business. Enterprise, with their ads today, an Enterprise ad, the one I remember last, shows this kid, he looks kind of frumpy, poorly dressed. You get the idea, he was kind of the social outcast in school. And the commercial shows the guy from Enterprise driving up in this nice Cadillac, Lincoln, some nice sizable car. And it's the kid's high school reunion, and he's renting the car because he wants to look good going to the high school reunion. And you will see Enterprise in hotels, you will see Enterprise in business centers, you will see Enterprise that comes to you, different from everybody else. And my gorilla from the automotive industry is a company called Rent-A-Wreck. Rent-A-Wreck has cars that are 5 or 6 years old. The lights work, everything works on the car. I'm just not going to rent one and drive it from here to New York. But around town at a fairly cheap price, it's a pretty good alternative. And my last example, hamburgers. McDonald's, clearly number one. And who attacks them, or who would like to attack them and be good, would be Burger King. And yet Burger King has problems and all kinds of challenges. If Burger King could do their job right, Burger King would do two things. Number one, they would point out that if you look through the little window back at McDonald's and you see how the hamburgers are cooked at McDonald's, that when they come out of the cooker, they're in this little greasy water thing, and that's how they keep them moist. Yeah. Did you want a McDonald's? You want a cheeseburger? Okay. And what was Burger King's thing about how they cooked their hamburgers? They were, flame broiled. They still have that. They still do it. But it's hidden in the back, so you can't see it. If they bring it to the front where you watched it and see, this is how ours are really cooked, and their slogan of have it your way, what if instead of just pulling hamburgers off the shelf, what if every time you ordered a hamburger at Burger King, you did truly order it, here's exactly how I want it made, and it was made right there, and you knew walking into Burger King, it was not going to be pulled off the shelf right there for you, that it was going to take an extra 2 or 3 minutes because they would prepare your hamburger exactly for you. So who is the flanker in their industry? It could be Wendy's, Taco Bell, Sonic, In-N-Out, Chick-fil-A, PDQ, all of them with a slightly different approach. I mean, Taco Bell, every 6 months, it's a different menu. They continue to change who they are. But the gorilla in the industry comes from down the street from me. So near my home is a McDonald's. And there's also a Wendy's. And we all know what their prices are for their food. And there's this little independent place called the Chataway, which has been there for a long, long time. Very old, longer than I am old. You've seen their hamburger in things like USA Today Weekend Edition is one of the best hamburgers in America. And on a day like today, when it's 80 degrees outside and it's not raining, if I go look at McDonald's, and if I go look at Wendy's, there's some people in the place, and there may be some people in the drive-thru. But come down the street to the Chataway, and people are parking 2 blocks away to get in there to eat a hamburger. That is $6.95. See, there's room in the marketplace for everybody. So I gave you examples of cars and rental cars and hamburgers, stuff that we experience all the time. But now let's take the experience back over to who we are and what we do. Are we trying to be something that we can't be? Are we trying to get in there and compete with PetSmart, Petco? Are we out there trying to compete with Walmart or Target or someone else out there? Are we trying to do things that we shouldn't be doing? See, what if my local hamburger stand tried to get out there and sell hamburgers for $1 a piece? They'd be out of business. The key is they don't have to. And my point is not that it's about price. It's about a business understanding who's who in the industry, who do I compete against, and how do I not play the game that they're playing? Because I can't play the game the way they play the game. I've got to be different. And that's my question to leave you with. Are you trying to be something you can't be? Do you need to be looking at something else different in the marketplace for you to be successful?